Have you ever wondered how we turn the alternating current, AC, from your wall outlet into the direct current, DC, that powers your gadgets? The answer lies in a little device called the Full Wave Bridge Rectifier. Hey guys, in this video, we're diving deep into how the Full Wave Bridge Rectifier works and why it's so crucial in electronics. A full wave rectifier is a device that converts AC into DC, making it perfect for powering most electronic circuits. A full wave bridge rectifier consists of four diodes arranged in a diamond shape, and its job is to allow current to flow in only one direction, effectively turning a fluctuating AC signal into a steady DC output. You'll typically see them represented in schematics like this one, where each diode allows current to flow in a specific path. But why do we need this conversion? While AC is what you get from wall outlets, most electronic devices, like your cell phone, need DC to operate. The rectifier ensures your devices receive a smooth, reliable current to keep them running. For example, a laptop charger takes the 120 or 240 volts AC from the wall and converts it to DC in the range from 18 to 20 volts to charge the laptop. For my laptop charger, I see an input voltage of 100 to 240 volts AC and an output voltage of 20.2 volts DC. In AC, the voltage constantly switches direction, moving forwards and backwards. This produces a sine wave pattern, where the voltage alternates between positive and negative peaks. For instance, in North America, the frequency is 60 hertz, meaning the wave completes 60 cycles per second. In many other countries, it's 50 hertz. In contrast, DC is more straightforward. Its voltage remains steady and positive. Imagine this 9-volt battery output. It's constant and flat, like a straight line on a graph. That's what electronic devices prefer, making rectifiers essential to converting wavy AC into stable DC. Now let's zoom in on the full wave rectifier itself. When connected to an AC source, the rectifier's four diodes work together to allow current to flow through the load in one direction, regardless of the AC polarity. During the positive half of the AC wave, diodes 1 and 2 conduct, allowing current to pass through the load. During the negative half, diodes 3 and 4 conduct, still allowing current to pass in the same direction through the load. This arrangement converts both halves of the AC cycle into a pulsating DC output. Let's see the full wave bridge rectifier in action by building a circuit that powers this red LED. This red LED has a maximum voltage of 2 volts. AC will be supplying 120 volts. To avoid burning out the red LED, I will use a step-down transformer to lower the voltage output from 120 volts to 12 volts. I have a power cord that I have cut the other end to expose the wires. The plug will be connected to a wall outlet. The other end will be connected to the transformer. Only the black and white wires will be used. The green wire isn't used, but for safety, connect it to a metal case. To connect the wires together, I will use wire caps. Twist the two black wires from the transformer with the black wire from the power cord. Insert these three wires into the wire cap. Twist the two red wires from the transformer with the white wire from the power cord. Insert these three wires into another wire cap. Connect the green wire with an alligator clip. I've stripped the wire on one end of the alligator clip so it can be connected to the green wire and placed inside the wire cap. Let's connect all the components into the breadboard. I'm going to start by setting up the full wave bridge rectifier. I'm using diode 1N4001. The bridge rectifier has four diodes arranged in a square. Each corner needs a specific connection for the bridge rectifier to work properly. For my configuration, the top and bottom diodes have the anodes on the left side. The left and right diodes have the anodes at the top. Bend the ends of the diode and insert it into the breadboard. This is the top of the square. Insert another diode into the bottom of the breadboard. The anode is on the left side again. This is the bottom of the square. Now I'm setting up the left and right side of the square. Hold the diode the same way where you have the anode on the left side and the cathode on the right. When you insert the diode into the breadboard, ensure the anode is at the top. This is the left side of the square. Insert the last diode to make the right side of the square. The two AC inputs from the transformer is at the top right and bottom left. The positive DC output is at the bottom right. The negative DC output is at the top left. Insert the jumper wire into the same column as the positive DC output. insert a jumper wire into the same column as the negative DC output. As you can see in the bottom right corner, two adjacent diodes have their cathodes meeting at a common point. At the top right corner, the other two diodes have their anodes meeting at a common point. Insert the jumper wires to the bottom left and top right corners. These two terminals are used to connect to the AC input. Insert a jumper wire near the middle of the breadboard. Ensure one end of the wire is inserted into the positive terminal and the other end is inserted into the middle of the breadboard. Insert another jumper wire in the same column as the previous jumper wire. Ensure one end of the wire is inserted into the negative terminal and the other end is inserted into the middle of the breadboard. For connecting the positive and negative terminals, we're going to use a capacitor. This is a 100 microfarads capacitor. A capacitor is used as a filter to smooth out the DC output by reducing the ripple created during the rectification process. By storing and releasing charge, the capacitor helps maintain a more consistent voltage level across the load, reducing fluctuations and making the DC output closer to a steady, flat line. Insert the capacitor in the same row as the last two jumper wires. Insert a jumper wire starting from the same row as the capacitor. Insert a jumper wire in the same row as the capacitor. I'm using a resistor to limit the current that flows through the LED. This is a 680 ohms resistor. Insert the left wire of the resistor in the same row as the red jumper wire. Insert a jumper wire in the same row as the resistor. The red LED is the last component to install in the breadboard. Insert the left leg of the LED in the same row as the jumper wire. Insert a jumper wire to connect the left and right sides of the breadboard. So let's connect the breadboard to the transformer. Connect the black jumper wire to the blue wire on the transformer. Secure the connection with a wire cap. Connect the red jumper wire to the yellow wire on the transformer. Make sure you twist the wires together before inserting them into the wire cap. The other blue wire isn't used, so you can insert it into a wire cap. Since we have completed the circuit, it's time to connect the power cord to the wall outlet. The LED lights up, so we have connected the circuit properly. We can use a multimeter to verify that the correct voltage is flowing through the LED. On the multimeter, turn the dial to the voltage setting. Touch the red probe to the left leg of the LED and the black probe to the right leg. The reading shows around 2 volts, which is what we expected. I hope this video has explained what is a full wave bridge rectifier. If you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up, consider subscribing for more electronics tips and tutorials, and hit the bell icon to never miss an update. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.